we can get the ball rolling.
Hello, I'm Jove Spucchi. While I don't yet have a neat descriptor for what it is I do, I've been a lifelong researcher, practitioner, and artist within the occult. My background is in technology and the arts, with more recent training in classical astrology and Buteau. More importantly, I've been a part of the nightlife as a dancer, DJ, booker, and promoter from the time I first snuck my way onto the dance floor as a teenager. Out of curiosity, how many of you here are clubgoers? Great, great. And how many of you would say that you find magic there? Yeah, me too. Dance floors have long been my temple, my respite, my place to explore. And at first, these club experiences were just opportunities to enjoy being in my body, playing with identity and moving energy around. But soon I came to realize that in these experiences, I was in conversation with things greater than myself. I would come home just as the world was waking up, still feeling the ghost of the drumbeat animating my body. Filled with a sense of wholeness and rightness with the world, these moments are often followed with excited voice recordings and shaky sketches of ideas gifted to me and later carved out on the dance floor. In the last 10 years, nightlife has become my primary group ritual space, a place where I've had the opportunity to create the conditions for transcendent experiences and to guide others in finding their own power through ecstasis. Today, I share with you my own emerging take on these topics, informed by many nights spent on dance floors, mostly within the American queer underground scene. Your experience may be, and should be, quite different. These magics, I feel, are at their best when they are rendered in forms specifically beautiful to a community or the desires of an individual. This type of magic is centered in the concept of ecstasis, displacement especially of the mind, the state of being outside oneself, totally lost in the experience of the other. Defined here from its usage in ancient Greek and Latin, we see the literal meaning of stasis, to stand, and ek, outside of, describing the experience of consciousness wrapped outward across the threshold of personhood, freshly differentiated as separate from the mundane self. But what is this other that possesses our attention, be it the spirit of an object, the magic of a symbol, or the intelligence of the extra human? The pleasure and fascination of the ecstatic experience leaves one visibly entranced. In this altered state, one is so wholly consumed and taken by the experience of this beautiful other, the temporality shifts, zooming in and focusing on the absolute presence of the moment. This presence offers what Heidegger calls a moment of vision, where, by breaking up the expected four on the floor rhythm of existence, we gain insights that empower us to more authentically be. Echoes of this idea are seen in the ancient Greek concept of kairos, particularly opportune openings in time where one may take critical action. In psychological parlance, we can describe ecstasis using Maslow's concept of the peak experience, a euphoric state of consciousness so thoroughly stimulating and imbued with meaning that one, if only briefly, realizes their potential in alignment with their desire. Maslow's research concludes that these experiences are most commonly had by those who are self-actualized, individuals who have broken free of mundane everydayness to inhabit the ideal forms of being for which they long. The simultaneous surrender to and embracing of desire is at the core of the ecstatic operation. Self-actualized individuals, the witch, the magician, the occultist, all exact their power through strength of will and a clever command of the fullness of agency. The power to choose predicates the power to change. It is through these choices that the magically inclined invite the conditions for ecstasis to occur. These conditions demand the full engagement of Freud's Eros, or the life drive, and ask us to deepen that engagement with the expanded dimensionality of Audre Lorde's most powerful erotic. I believe that this push to a fuller experience and embodiment of the erotic is an inherently queer, inherently magical way of being in the world. Inclusive of the feminine, its empowered creativity and oceanic depths of feeling. This queering of existential intent can be compared to Burroughs and Geisen's cut-up method, the interruption and rending of the established order as a way of realizing the fullness of possibility. It is in the art of sampling and the remix where we often find our deepest connection to a track. In the dark, chaotic swirl of the nightclub, we swim in a splash of that primordial creative potential. It is through ecstasis that we give it form and are able to pull knowledge, energy, and inspiration back into our baseline reality. But how does one do this? What are the levers we can pull to attract the ecstatic? Here I propose a few of the ideas we can connect with, practically, abstractly, or in their personified forms. The first being liminality. What thresholds of routine, self-doubt, or imposed norms can you play with, fuck with, dismantle? I feel that queer and underground nightlife spaces often exist for the purpose of this type of healing. Here, we encourage partygoers and musicians alike to self-express at the margins of both style and taste. Next, mutability. How easily can the rules of the status quo be bent or broken? How can you change yourself, your way of being? How can you affect change in the people around you? Again, nightlife has many niches to choose from and forms of expression and desire to experiment with. There are near infinite ways to experience the night, and there are even more ways to impact someone else's. Discomfort. How can we unbind the tethers of ease and complacency that so often hold us back? Experiencing others flaunting and playing with their shadows on the dance floor is a powerful mirror that shows us how things might be if we broke through the glass ceiling of our own self-limitation. And finally, randomness. How might we invite novel opportunities and choices into our experience in order to learn and grow? Every moment in the chaos of the nightclub is its own crossroads opportunity. Who will you find there? What will you ask? What will they show you? Purveyor of these forms, Mercury is the mutable psychopomp who may exist in all states, transcending all thresholds to move freely across, between, and through them. Nightlife presents an opportunity to partake in Mercury's regular dance of retrograde or katabasis, a journey through the underworld so replete with both gnosis and ordeal that it leaves the dancer transformed. This dance of personal myth-making is made rich through wielding these ecstatic forms to define ourselves, not by the stories projected upon us, but through the exploration of our own agency, creativity, and depths of feeling. In doing so, we are in conversation with the legacy of the occulted, those who were othered from the world in their more expansive and thus transgressive experiences of Eros. Whether it is the prototype of the shaman or the witch, othered and occulted individuals have been holders of magical power throughout human history. Often living at the liminal edge of the hedge, their work involves crossing over into different realms or experiences, communicating with extra human entities to gather information or enact change, often for the good of the community. With the rise of more solar Apollonian thought and power structures, hastened by the spread of colonialism across the globe, these othered individuals were eventually seen as a threat to the patriarchal order. And increasingly, they began to work under the cover of night to avoid the ascending threat of violent persecution. While the scope of this talk, unfortunately, does not permit a true cross-cultural analysis of this history, I've selected two core examples of the shift into the dark and revelry in the Dionysian. The persecution of the mystery cults of late antiquity and their thread to the witch's Sabbath, both as imagined during the Inquisition and as later reified by practitioners in the UK and beyond. Both of these traditions present initiates with direct and unmediated access to divinity through the invocation of ecstatic states. The erotic indulgences of dancing and sex, feasting and intoxication, were often used to both gather and dissipate energy surrounding a ritual. Here we see clear connections to the nightclub experiences of modernity. Secret or unspoken understandings of ritual wear and imagery, special chants, greetings and incantations, symbolic handshakes and shared choreographies. Enhanced the experience with mind-altering substances, taboo play, and a sexy party vibe for highly curated, full-spectrum stimulation, if you're in the know and on the list. All this starts to sound a bit like a good night out to me. The deviant pleasures and dalliances of the modern club experience are linked to a countercultural legacy reaching back to the early pubs and drinking clubs in Europe and America. In the US, we see early examples of this in underground prohibition-era speakeasies and jazz clubs, establishing our choice cocktail of dancing, chemically altered states, and a particularly erotic defiance of the rules. This milieu is further explored in the disco culture of the 1970s, which brought together queer folks and people of color in dance-centered spaces. Here, they were free to experiment with vibrant aesthetics, more open sexualities, and new ranges of sensual experience expanded in the stylish alternates of the time, poppers, quaaludes, and cocaine. In the late 70s and early 80s, Chicago underground greats like Frankie Knuckles and Ron Hardy pioneered the defining genre of electronic dance music, house music. Characterized by its driving bassy 4/4 rhythms and syncopated high ends, it relied on the accessible sounds of the Roland 303, 808, and 909 synthesizers that we hear all throughout our favorite contemporary dance tracks. Coupled with samples of gospel choirs and inspirational sermon-like spoken word clips, house music sought to evoke the feelings of togetherness found in ecstatic religious fellowship. Playing primarily for black gay men, Knuckles was one of the first DJs to popularize the continuous mix of records in the style we are most familiar with today. This endless stream of body-moving beats gives the party space its own temporality, a rhythm that propels the dancer into deeper and deeper states of embodiment and ecstasy. Spreading to Europe and beyond, the inspiring energy of house music was then metabolized as a mimetic base for the many genres that defined the rave culture of the 90s. Faster BPMs, faster drugs, and a resistance to the increasing attempts to snuff out its growth. The UK's Criminal Justice and Public Order Act of 1994 was a direct attack on the broadening popularity of raves, specifically targeting free events and traveler communities by eliminating existing rights and increasing penalties for unlicensed parties. This attempt at suppression further established rave and its nightlife lineage as a form of protest. Its liminality, mutability, and ephemerality made it difficult to define and impossible to fully restrict or diminish. Even when large parties were shut down, smaller DIY events would quickly fill the void, a trend we still see today. The nature of the ecstatic or peak experience that revelers find on the dance floor is not something that can be taken away. It is woven into the fabric of these upgraded and queered identities, formed through healthy enmeshment with the spiritual. Raves, and festivals in particular, can be likened to Peter Lamborn Wilson's concept of the temporary autonomous zone, which he published as Hakim Bey. While he was critical of techno's understanding of the idea, the core tenets of distributing and eliminating centers of control is foundational in many of the queer festivals and gatherings that I've been able to attend. Avoidance of any formal hierarchical control structure or relationship is achieved through centering ephemerality and focusing deeply on the joy, beauty, and singularity of the present moment. This presence harkens back to our earlier definition of ecstasis, the escape from the formal structures and placement of self in an all-consuming evanescent moment. Redefining the raver as something greater than they were before. This demand to be defined by one's own empirical experience is a radical act of resistance to the structures designed to police away any divergence from the comfortably known and understood. These same conditions for resistance serve as a boundless latent space, potentiated with the infinite richness that comes with defining something as other from, rather than confining it within the symbolic. In truly queer nightlife spaces, it is this celebration of otherness that coheres the group, rather than adherence to any singular aesthetic or archetype. We see this alterity valued in the club kid culture that started in the late 80s, where creatives like Lee Bowery and Suzanne Bartsch pushed on every boundary and restriction to help create these fertile spaces where different selves could be explored. And we see Lee Bowery's incredible outfits here, which he both designed and constructed. And this one in particular, on the bottom right, we still see all throughout club culture today that ponytail updo and very BDSM-inspired mask. Even outside of big cities, though, like New York and London, rave culture invited people to explore and experiment. Trans DJ and T4T Love Energy label owner Eris Drew cites rave as the place where she could first truly see herself. Growing up in the conservative Midwest, it wasn't until her ecstatic experiences of the mother beat that she first felt she could truly realize her identity in community. The occultedness of underground nightlife offers many shadows to dance and play within, and I found that the organizers in this world are very supportive of anyone who is authentically engaged in the ecstatic and creative experiment that is expanding the boundaries of self. As a method to explore identity, I propose the concept of total personae, the creation and embodiment of a fully vivacious and engaging character. Meant to totally stimulate the channeler, this is one method of reaching ecstasis that we see explored in the nightlife. Drag queens, club kids, and legendary party hosts, each of them in full expression of a novel possible self. Hair, makeup, clothes, posture, voice, affect, all dialed in to create a field and resonance with their desire. I liken the self-sovereignty of chosen identity to Anton LaVey's concept of total environments. Aesthetically and behaviorally consistent pocket realities attuned to our own pleasures, allowing us to reach a sort of erotic homeostasis. For the moments when we cannot be in the totality of our preferred environment, we can instead channel a character from that world and project it into the surrounding space, a portable, nearly total environment. When this persona comes from a place of authenticity and alignment with desire, one taps into the magic of the peak experience, ecstasis in self-actualization. This moment is one of full realization, awareness, and embodiment of the desired ideal self. It is from this place of reflexive cognizance that we may prime ourselves to intentionally engage with the spiritual other. When one develops a strong felt sense of how their own spirit permeates and propels the body, they are better equipped to experiment with the mysteries of surrender. The surrender of the body is something that many have likely encountered in its more ambient form, the compulsion to corporeally express the beats and rhythms of a song so infectious in its motion that one finds themselves engaged in involuntary dance. It is through the practice of buteau that I have learned to more intentionally engage with this channeling of aesthetics. Be it a form of the natural, supernatural, or human-made world, buteau situates the spirit of the other on the same level as the human, equal in its potential for mimetic exploration. In these explorations, the dancer may mime their experience of an imagistic yet unlikely phrase, such as wavering stone. In replicating the properties of this phrase across the medium of the body, they are communing with what we might call the lived experience of the thing described, taking on its perceived and imagined properties as their own. This experiential, sensual knowledge of the thing is the invitation, and likely the act of, relations itself. To know is to fuck. Here I draw heavily from Alcissus the Mech's 2011 talk, The Mirror of Sacrifice, which so beautifully likens the dancer's body to a crucible, a relatively safe and known environment where one can experiment in forging relationships with the spiritual other. This crucible is purpose-built for the mimetic conversation, those sympathetic magics described by Fraser and contextualized by Tosic as replication of the power of a thing through imitation and contact. As a dance partner to the spiritual other, we pour our spirit into the crucible along with the entity we're both mirroring and carnally getting to know. To fire this crucible, one must raise energy in the body, entering meditative or martial states of complete focus. This can be done in many ways: repetitive movements, breath work, spinning, or moving to the point of exhaustion, all of which you might very well see through the fog of the dance floor. This is the disruption of that erotic homeostasis, the dysregulation of the nervous system for the heightening of the senses, preparation of awareness for embodying the other. This ecstatic embodiment can also be achieved through second order mimesis, donning the symbols or imaginal representation of the thing as a way of calling upon its spirit. This is both the technology of the ceremonial magician and the psychonaut, engaging the animistic sympathies between ritual objects and their associated spirits to craft the optimal set and setting for ecstasis. These symbols form the palette of sensual information that give the total environment and total persona their erotic richness. The visual, aural, olfactory, and tactile senses all engage to focus the mind with the presence of moment and direction of will. Club nights that seek to connect with the reveler across each of these facets are the ones that have left the greatest impression on me. When the spirit of the community can be felt in each of the senses, a clear direction of will, a consistent invitation of a particular thought form or egregore, true immersion occurs. Decor, music, crowd, looks, the smell of fog and pheromones are all synchronized in a mimetic dance that weaves a narrative for the mind to connect with, a role for the total persona to play. The shamanic narrative structure found in rites of passage and katabasis forms the ritual backbone for mystery cult operations, witch's sabbat, and the nightlife experience alike. The preparatory rituals of adorning oneself in clothes, makeup, oils, and perfumes, the taking of psychoactive ritual sacrament, are followed by a descent into the underworld of the nightclub. We go here to find the elusive object of our quest, a playmate or partner among the sea of souls, or the summoning of the other through ecstasis. After this ordeal involving the metaphorical sacrifice or offering of the body, we return with the sun ascending to the realm of the living. Participation in this narrative interleaves us within the tapestry of our magical, queer, and othered elders, a legacy that offers us empowerment through mythic tradition and mimesis of the greats, both old and new. Be it Orpheus, Inanna, Odin, or Dante, or the many great occultists and club icons of modernity, we tell our collective story of living magically, empowered in our creativity and rightful claim to agency. We craft more beautiful, spiritually enmeshed futures. As we step into these futures together, the great work is to bring our most realized selves, our truest desires, and most beautiful shadows. It is through ecstasis, the displacement of the current self, that we may bring about this transcendence of limitations, both real and imagined. To truly know ourselves, we must have knowledge of the other, conversations that help us find and then push on the edges of who we are. This is a queering, an occulting of the body, mind, and spirit. It is the choice to sit in our discomfort and embrace the opportunity of the dark unknown. Well, I find, and believe many of you will find, that nightlife is a fecund ground for this type of exploration. These legacies of liminality and shamanic engagement can be explored on your own, in whatever lineage or discipline you are engaged in. Whether you are just forming your magical practice or fortified in long-standing relationships with spirit, there is always a horizon of ordeal and further transformation to encounter and communion with the other. In the resounding words of Lady J, see a cliff, jump off. Thank you.